so that our public and private sector objectives are aligned, and it also has a real concrete program for action and agendas. We're looking forward to walking through, at the technical briefing, a more detailed review of the report. It concentrates on six areas where better access and progress will close the gap for gender equality: education, family planning, maternal child health, financial inclusion, and digital inclusion, and perhaps the largest of all in both developed and fast growth economies is assistance with unpaid care work, assistance with unpaid domestic work. In each of these areas, we concentrate on delivering millions of people, women and men, boys and girls, improved access to services, building the platform that we think in the next decade, 2025, could make real progress towards the SDGs. Secondary education, as an example, 58 million girls and 60 million boys would be need to enroll in schools above the current plans to get closer to the SDG objectives. 224 million women would need access to formal financial services, and by that we simply mean a bank account. 29 to 57 million women would need to increase their participation in the global labor force to be able to work outside the home, but also to want to. An equivalent number of men would need to be covered by shared paid family leave. A final example, 445 million more people would need access to water and sanitation services. I spent a couple of years living and working as a midwife in Senegal, West Africa, in the US Peace Corps, and have seen firsthand something as simple as access to clean water, sanitation, and preparing the home for the day, how much time that takes for women and girls. In a different context, in a leading global city, working and living in London as I do at the moment, seeing the trade-offs that parents, young couples, are making to try and make their family work with the trade-offs on parental leave and trying to make sure that they're doing the best for their families. Whether in developing markets and fast growth economies or large developed cities and countries, the topic of unpaid care and domestic work is a major lever for closing the gap. Nothing in life is free. How much would all of this cost? We estimate that between $1.5 and $2 trillion more dollars in incremental public household, private, or individual spending, so public, private, or household spending would be needed. This is above and beyond what would be spent anyway. We make no apology for that. But if you compare that to the prize, the $12 trillion Parity Prize that would come from best-in-region scenarios, that's 6 to 8 times return. It's well worth the investment, both in economic development, but more importantly, the numbers, millions of lives transformed. Realizing the full potential for women and girls is an ambitious agenda and would require collaborative action between governments, the private sector, and many NGOs. And that requires prioritization, not only on the six areas that I've highlighted in our most recent report, but also some of the issues around legal protection, political voice for women and girls, and of course, a reduction in violence against women. These things go hand in hand, and I think I would not be overstating it to say that as we think about the work that McKinsey Global Institute has done, this has been a major addition to our thinking of how we can collaborate both the levers for gender in society as well as gender in the economy. Change is ambitious but achievable, and the good news is with focused and targeted interventions that scale well, we are confident that progress can be made on a 2025 timeframe. We have 75 interventions covered in the report, over 150 case examples, many of whom are represented here at Women Deliver, and lots of examples where cities, companies, countries, or simply villages have collaborated well to deliver these goals. Education, building more secondary schools, sanitation facilities for girls, financial incentives, cash transfers to raise enrollment, and many other strategies to improve quality and engagement in education. Family planning and maternal health. Actions include increased number of health workers, developing emergency planning services, public campaigns that included digital access to reach young people, and of course, simple access to supplies, supply chains for delivery, stocking of contraceptives, and education around comprehensive sex education for girls and boys. Financial and digital inclusion, a major lever in both developed as well as emerging economies. Interventions include policies that support universal access to savings, credit accounts, digital and mobile platforms, and increasing affordability. Simple digital literacy, having a mobile phone, knowing how to use it, and connecting with an innovative financial institution, public or private, that provides you access to that account. And of course, as I've stressed, unpaid work. Each region needs to develop an ecosystem for thinking about childcare services, whether it's government subsidized, employer assisted, or self-funded. A mix of these models can help close the gap and free up women and girls, free up families to choose how to spend their time as they support their household and also raise their families. These are just a few examples of good practices that we've seen as we've gone through our work, and really are looking forward to sharing more of those examples during the Women Deliver Conference. Ambition and measurable progress are important to achieve these goals, and we are very confident that with more progress that we can capture the full prize.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to move us right along and go immediately to Sruthi Chandrasekaran. I wrote it down that time. Sruthi's research specialist at the South Asia Research Hub of the United Kingdom's Department for International Development. As I said before, she's one of Women's Deliver's outstanding young leaders. And she's been working very, very hard to use data to inform policy decisions around sexual and reproductive health sector in developing countries. Sruthi.
Thank you. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. Data is critical, but it's of no use if you can't get your message across. Have you ever felt that you have a seat at the table, but no one's listening to you? Have you ever felt that you're just a box on someone's checklist that they needed to tick off? I'm a Women Deliver young leader, and I refuse to be just a box on someone's checklist. Young people are no longer just asking to be part of the decision-making process today. They are part of the process. And I'd like to offer two examples of how I do this at work every day. One of the goals of FP 2020 is to have an additional 120 million users by 2020. But how can we achieve this without compromising on the quality of care? I needed to communicate this to a non-technical audience, and I was trying to think of a parallel. I thought of the experience of receiving counseling for contraception as similar to that of getting a haircut. If you're anything like me, it's probably long overdue. I'm usually quite nervous. I don't know what I'm looking for, but I want to come out feeling like a million bucks. I want to know that I can have a warm, friendly conversation with my hairdresser, that the information we share is confidential, that I can come back if I don't like what I got or if I needed a related service. But now imagine if this service had to be scaled up for 120 million users. What would that imply for the quality of care? I might be oversimplifying the problem, but I found that it was a really good way to start a conversation with the audience. My second example was when I was reviewing a multi-level quantitative analysis plan on understanding the determinants of intimate partner violence. The hypothesis was that there were two main factors, one, community-level factors, and second, characteristics of the perpetrators, the men. I pushed the researchers to think about what was in the secondary data about the women. What was women's decision-making power in these countries? What was their attitude towards violence? What was their attitude about negotiating safe sex with their partners? And that really helped change the conversation. And I do this at work every day. I ask questions, I push the boundaries. I push for evidence-based decision-making. And I work across generations, and this is not easy. It's quite hard. But like me, 200 other young women, women deliver young leaders, are doing this every day. And the reason we do this is because people and institutions along the way have trusted us. They've invested in us, believing we can make a change. And so here we are. We have a say, we have a stake in these issues, and we're here to stay. Invest in young people and invest in women and girls, because we're delivering for women and girls, we're delivering for young people, and you should too. Thank you.
Thank you, Sruthi. And our third and final speaker is Katia Everson from Women Deliver. I'm not going to go into all of her history, but she's a leading global advocate around investments in health, in well-being, but most importantly, in the rights of women and girls, and has a long history around maternal, sexual, and reproductive health in particular. Katia.
Thank you very much. Just as a comment to my two friends here on what has been said, for me, the bottom line is women count them, and count them in. If we don't know where people live, if we don't know who they are, their income, their age, how can we ever make good policies or implement what it is that we need to get done? And we need to get done a lot. We know that. When Women Deliver first started our first conference in London in 2007, at that point we had 500,000 women dying in childbirth, one every minute. Way too many. Most of them could be saved even by then by known interventions, and it was not rocket science. And at that time also hundreds of millions women did not have access to contraception. You know, it was also looking at schooling. Today, this, thanks to a lot of partners and a lot of unusual partners, there's much greater political and financial knowledge, but also knowledge, commitment, but also, as we see today, new institutions who have started working on data on the investment case for girls and women. I know McKinsey has been doing it for quite a while, but aligning it with the Sustainable Development Goals, aligning it with what some of the things we're trying to achieve with this conference is just so great, because we as advocates and as a small advocacy organization, we don't have that ability to do that, but when we choose to work with people who have, we will all move the agenda and the whole argumentation forward. So there has been great accomplishment, and we are so happy to celebrate that this week, but our eye is also set on the future, because we cannot just lean back and relax and put our feet on the table. The job is not done. So, as we see it, it is time to deliver for every woman and every girl, and let me add everywhere, because this is also in crisis situations, and the tide is turning. So, we try to put, also with this conference, the whole woman, the whole girl at the center of development, as drivers of development, because we can't look at a body part, or we can't look at just a disease or a single issue, because then we'll keep building silos, and that is both too expensive and non-efficient. So, I don't know if you heard the commitment that Cecilia read yesterday in the plenary. It was just that kind of, it is about giving girls and women healthcare, and they will deliver resilient families, give girls and women the potential to learn, and they will deliver stronger economies, as we've seen a good example here, give girls and women opportunities, and they will deliver solutions. So I know I told you about it yesterday, but we have the Deliver for Good campaign. This is the version for the pocket and the purse. This is the bigger one, and we have all the policy briefs where you can get all data, solutions, and benefits. Don't want to talk more about that, but happy to do it bilaterally, but it is putting the gender lens and the gender focus on the Sustainable Development Goals. This goes way beyond what's called goal number 5 on gender equality. This is cross-cutting. So we know what it'll take to unlock the potential of girls and women around the world, and the investments are proven, and they are, thanks for the new research, also affordable. To me, it sounds like a winner case if we gain 12 trillion by investing, was it 1 to 2? Mm-hmm. It's not often you'd have that return on investments, I'd say. And also, if we look, keep in the business language, which business would throw 50% of their potential to the wayside? Let's count the women in. So we just have to really take it from here, you know, after yesterday and feeling the energy that's been here, it's been tremendously wonderful, and we hope it continues for the next 3.5 or 2.5 days. But it's also extremely important that it continues further. So that widespread recognition really needs to be sustained, and we're looking forward to working with every single institution that can differentiate the argumentation, both the rights argument, which is pretty set, it is a human right, girls and women are equal participants, but it is also the economic and the social argumentation. Girls and women carry a lot more than babies and water. They carry the fantastic and huge potential and to deliver both stronger economies and societies. Girls and women deliver for good.
Thank you, Katia. And so now that you've heard from our three speakers, I want to turn it over to you for some questions. We'll take three questions at a time. If you can put your hand up, someone at the back will bring you a microphone. And if you can just say who you are and try and keep your questions as brief as possible. There's a hand over there.
First of all, thank you very much for the presentations. I think it's very interesting. My name is Suzanne Lassen. I would like to hear, Vivian, to which degree in your studies have you, and how have you reached out to some of the religious institutions which have a tremendous power, for instance, in the Middle East? I take the example of Sakina Yacoubi, who opened up the speech yesterday by talking about how she had talked with the mullahs. How do you actually think about that in your context? Have you looked into that in your survey, what role they have and how they can, how you can act with them to get some of this going?
Thank you. We'll take two more questions before the panel. So there's one at the back there, and then maybe we can have one from the virtual audience.
Thank you very much. My name's Liz Ford. I work for The Guardian in London. I'm just really asking about, obviously, you've got to find an extra $2 trillion. Sounds like an incredible amount when aid budgets being cut, when UN agencies are having shortfalls and everything else. Where's the money going to come from? Where are we going to get that $2 trillion from?
Thank you. And then one from the virtual audience down here, please.
Thank you. This comes from one of our virtual audience members. Women and girls are capable of driving economic development for any country. The challenge is many can hardly access funds to start their businesses. How could women and girls be assisted financially to overcome this challenge, given this report?
Okay, so two of them actually are dealing with finance. So if I could ask each of you who want to respond, but as briefly as possible so we can get some more questions in. So Vivian, do you want to start?
Well, I'll start with the investment case and then perhaps come back to how that can help support the practical initiatives, public, private, and third sector. It's very clear that the investment we're estimating is incremental to what governments and organizations are planning to do now. We don't believe that you can get gender participation up in society and up in workforce without a change in some of the plans and some investment. And we also believe that front-loading some of that investment, working hard on the educational inputs, creative policies around unpaid care outside of work, are worth making because we know that will free up more families and free up more women to participate in the economy in the way that they choose. That said, remember that additional capacity within the economy also grows the economy, and that will provide funding in and of itself. So our estimates are that 60% of the incremental funding can be financed through the returns from the increased economic participation. We absolutely have to invest first, but we know when we grow the economy, a large share of that will be recovered through the investment itself. Secondly, collaborations with public, private, partnerships working on programs, whether they be religious organizations, traditional non-secular NGOs, existing private sector collaborations, and public sector initiatives, but working with programs that we know already work and scaling those is also a very efficient way to make the investments and then capture that return. So we think it's achievable.
I'd just like to reflect on your question. I think a part of that is being disruptive. I think young people need to be disruptive, and women and girls need to be disruptive. We need to be in positions of power. And a lot of that has to do with capacity building. I was formerly a global health co-fellow. Now I'm a women deliver young leader. And opportunities like these really help in building the skills that one needs to make your way up. So change can only happen if we're being disruptive.
If I may just add a part to the economic empowerment question that came online, if I should just kind of point to a couple of issues that have been, what is it that we need? We need economic literacy, that's kind of access to a bank account. You know, I know in some parts of the world having access to a bank account is just something we have. Many places women actually don't have that. We've seen that when you have access to a bank account or when your salary is transferred to a bank account, so you don't come home with them in an envelope or a little bag, gender-based violence also go down. So that access to cash transfers, loan, credit, and secured land rights. There's also very many places in the world where you have very low level of female-owned land, either because you, through legislation, are not allowed to own land, or inheritance is not, that you can't get it that way. And then continue to track and measure unpaid work, because it is such a, how many percentage was it? It's a lot that you really have to track that. So that's just some of the issues related to financial empowerment, economic empowerment. On the faith-based, absolutely. As we see it, we work with everybody who can move the agenda, and you look at who are the influencers in communities, in societies, and their faith. What is it? Many villages, it's the teacher and the preacher, mm-hmm. No matter what kind of color, that are the people you turn to. So working with those institutions is really important. We did it, not Women Deliver per se, but the whole movement around maternal mortality did it in the sense that we agreed around, just kind of no, hardly anybody disagree in the sentence, no woman should die giving life. You know, people do agree that women should not die in childbirth. We might kind of have different strategies to achieve that, where there can be differences, but that doesn't mean that we can't start a conversation. So the conversation will often start where there's agreement instead of where there's disagreement. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you very much to all three of you. Actually, I'm going to wrap up the questions for now. There'll be time for some additional questions after the second group of panelists. I think we've all had very clear explanations around the why of investing in women and girls. Some of your questions have been about the how and how you make it happen. And I think some of that is about reprioritizing our idea of what works. And, oh, we can? Okay, sorry. They're telling me that actually we can have some more questions. Okay, so are there any more questions in the audience here? Okay, there's someone down here. And then just behind, two rows behind.
Hi, I'm Annalisa Morelli from Quartz. I wanted to ask you a question about if there are any models that have been tested on sort of sharing childcare or like helping families with childcare, because you mentioned it's a burden to many young families in general, mm-hmm. and often like private finances are not enough to cover mm-hmm. that. Like that's part of the burden. So,
okay, and then just behind.
My question is very similar. I was just going to ask how unpaid care work factors into this economic plan, and you know who's going to do it if more women are in the workforce. And
mm-hmm. Men? No. There's a question down here and then one there. So we'll take the two more and then we'll finish.
It was encouraging to see in the paper that there's more inclusion of men in projects to encourage female empowerment, especially because so many societies are patriarchal. I was just wondering to what extent that will happen, and if you've seen sort of positive results of case studies of this.
Okay, and then the final question down here.
My name is Musimbi Kanyura. I'm from the Global Fund for Women. I want to acknowledge the McKinsey report that has been there now for several months. I felt like it went shy of naming why women don't access this, because it did give us really good data for what parity would look like, but never mentioned that violence against women prevents them from getting to any of these places. When will we have businesses name violence against women as an issue that prevents success?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so if we go in the same order again, Vivian, then Sruthi, then Katya.
There was no question that the topic of unpaid care work is probably the single largest topic area. And we've actually were encouraged when we looked at some of the case studies on innovative approaches for addressing it. Paid family or parental leave, and there we deliberately say family and parental, not leave for women or maternity leave, because it's about how a family or a unit makes the decision and making it economically neutral, available to both members of a family, and driving the numbers of participation up. So offering comparable leave, more days of paid maternity leave, more days of paid parental leave. Formal childcare, looking at ways of networked childcare where you have more sharing of childcare, particularly in the pre-primary school years, and early childhood education, so higher quality carers, but perhaps working in more innovative models. You could have sharing and self-funding programs in a village or in a workplace. So there are lots of examples of getting at family support services so that families can make different decisions that free you up to be able to go and work comfortable, that your children are well cared for. Basic services are also very important in unpaid care work as well. Water, sanitation, energy. Those are platform investments that typically the public sector needs to make in collaboration with private sector partners. And so we're not naive that some of these investments require more than just an employer or more than just a family to make a difference. You need a platform investment across an economy or across an ecosystem to really be able to make it work. When you make a platform investment in a village, say around sanitation or water services, or better programs for parental leave, you actually help both women and men. So we're optimistic that it'll result in more benefits to men and women. Gender neutrality is not the goal, it's just the outcome. When you actually invest in women and girls, you're actually investing in boys and men as well.
Okay, can I ask you just one word each, because we've got the next panel meeting. Thanks.
I just wanted to respond to your question about violence against women and how do we get businesses to respond. I think there are interventions where organizations work with garment factory workers and talk to them about how to combat violence against women. And I think those are proving to be effective. The data, there is some data, but there is more data that's being commissioned. So.
Thank you. Katya?
Yeah, and mine is a little along the same way. We need to look at what the private sector can also do in the supply and the value chain. We're seeing companies today who are instituting family-friendly policies, which is kind of that overarching frame for it, and because they have done the economic analysis, for example, having maternity leave, how that makes women come back to the work, to the labor force, to the company, and that investment that's been made in knowledge and in education really, really pays off. So it's interesting that we have countries, big countries in the world, who do not have any maternity leave on the legislative books, but there these big companies actually do it because they know it pays off.
Okay, thank you all very much. Thank you for your comments, thank you for your questions. I'd like to wrap this up now, and I'd now like to welcome Melinda Gates, Ambassador Kathy Russell, and Ambassador Natasha Stott-Despoja. and Mr. Papasek, who are going to be talking about an exciting new initiative. So thank you. Okay, so thank you all very much. While everyone's settling down, as you can see, we've been joined by four amazing advocates who really are doing a lot of work in closing the gender gap, in reaching towards the investments that we want to make in women and girls, as you heard with the panel before, because that investment, that development is something that works for the whole of the world and for all of our well-being. So I'm honored to introduce Melinda Gates, co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Ambassador Kathy Russell, who's ambassador at large for global women's issues for the US State Department, Ambassador Natasha Stott-Disposia, Ambassador for Women and Girls in the Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and finally, Papasek, who's the Policy and Statistics Specialist at UN Women, who will be answering some of the questions at the end with the Q&A. So first of all, I'm really delighted and honored to invite Melinda Gates to make her comments. I think many of you have heard of the work of the Gates Foundation. My personal pleasure, though, Melinda, is that what I love is that you not only went to speak to the women and girls who are most affected by some of the issues that we're working on, but you then listened, and in listening, you changed the way in which you make things happen, both in terms of investments and other areas, and I just think that that is such a wonderful example to set to people. So thank you, and I'll hand over to you.
Great, thank you. Well, I fundamentally have a belief that empowered women transform societies. And I see it all over the world. Everywhere I go, there's this tremendous opportunity with women, and yet we don't always give them that opportunity. And so the announcement that our foundation made today that we are going to invest $80 million to help help close some of the data gaps that exist and add new data to this community is really to further this commitment that these 193 leaders made. They ratified the SDGs, and when I look back at the previous Millennium Development Goals, the progress we made in maternal mortality, in child mortality, is because we could measure and count and see how we were doing against those goals. And so with SDG 5 set, we now need to look at what indicators we have and where we have gaps to fill. And so this is our moment to say this is where we're going to look to fill those gaps, because if we're going to go and ask governments to program against these, to make investments, we're going to ask other philanthropists to make investments, civil society, we have to know what it is that counts. And today, women are undervalued and undercounted, and we're going to change that. And so that's what our announcement was about today.
Thank you very much. Thank you both for the comments and for your continued commitment towards gender equality. I'd like to now introduce Ambassador at Large for Women's Global Issues, Ambassador Kathy Russell.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Melinda, for this important announcement. I really appreciate it. I think it's hugely helpful. I'm going to make just a couple of quick comments today about what the U.S. government is doing and how we look at these issues. A couple of weeks ago, I spent some time with a woman named Maureen who is an activist from Malawi, and she told me the story about how when she was 11 years old, her family sent her to live with a neighboring family or friends of her parents. She in exchange for school fees and some money for her family, she did housework for this family. And at some point, when she was 11, the father in that family raped her, and she got HIV and had just a horrible tale of things that followed that. The interesting thing to me about that story, as heartbreaking as it is that Maureen took what happened to her and decided to become an activist. And she speaks out about gender-based violence. She tries to change the ideas about HIV in her country, which is really incredibly impressive for such a young woman. And she was an important reminder to me that women, while very often are victimized, and there's no question about that around the world, I see it almost every day in my job, they are also much more than victims. They're leaders and they're champions in their own right. And her story to me illustrates that while there are many barriers facing women and girls, gender-based violence, poverty, access to education, access to healthcare, and discrimination, that's only part of the story. And I think it's important for us to keep that in mind. These challenges are numerous, and they are immense. But the fact is that we will not be able to address this long list of challenges without good data. And that's why this announcement today is so important. There is a clear call in the gender community. I hear it in every event that I go to, that we need more data, we need more refined data, we need sex disaggregated data. I mean, it is a constant challenge in the work that we do. From the State Department perspective, this issue is, for us, a matter of both supply and demand. We have a role to play in supplying data. We're doing a lot of work around the world. We collect and we analyze it in our work, but we need to share that. And that is critical to our ability to understand and respond to the incredible challenges we see around the world, particularly as we all hopefully are trying to meet the SDGs. That's why the department is very proud to anchor this Global Partnership for Sustainable Development data. And it's why we've incorporated data into our work on HIV/AIDS in particular. PEPFAR is now collecting and making available data disaggregated by sex and age to inform our efforts to meet the urgent and complex needs of adolescent girls and of women. And it's really an critically important and, I think, valuable contribution that PEPFAR is making. We're also looking to use new partnerships to collect and analyze data. And just at one example, we started a partnership a few months ago with Kiva, which is an online lending platform, and we launched the Women's Entrepreneurship Fund, which is really terrific because it will match dollar for dollar in what individuals donate on the Kiva Fund. But most importantly for the United States government, they're going to track the data about who's taking the loans, how they're repaying them, what they're using them for. We don't have that data right now, and especially in the economic field, there's a dearth of data about what's happening with women. And the bottom line for us is that partnership and coordination are absolutely critical to almost any effort that we're engaged in, and gender data is certainly no different from that. From our perspective, working together, pooling our resources, coordinating, avoiding duplication makes the best use of all of the limited resources that we have. So I'm very glad to be here today, especially in such great company. We're tremendously grateful for this. And I would just close where I started, which is, for Maureen and for the millions of women and girls around the world who are depending on us, I think we can all do a better job. And if we have the information that shows us where the gaps are, what the challenges are, what the successes are, we're all going to do a lot better by Maureen and women and girls around the world. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Russell. And finally, I'd like to introduce Ambassador Stott Dispoja, who's the Australian Ambassador for Women and Girls, and who's responsible for promoting Australian government policies regarding gender equality.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Of course, I begin by acknowledging Linda Gates and her extraordinary speech and contribution today. You managed to do something we've all been trying to do. You're making data interesting. Thank you.
I don't know about that. We'll try.
To Papa Sec, and of course to my friend and US counterpart, Cathy Russell, it's such a pleasure to join this esteemed group of individuals today who are all committed to advancing gender equality and empowering women and girls. You've heard that the gender data gaps are pervasive. They're particularly acute, indeed, when we're trying to measure the prevalence of violence against women, or we're looking at the issue of access to income or social protection for women, and indeed when it comes to measuring the quality and the quantity of women's work. It's absolutely right that we can't do this without significant investment in closing the data gender gaps. Without it, we're not going to be able to realise the ambitions of the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. Australia's really pleased. We're very proud to support the UN Women's Flagship Program, making every woman and girl count. We're supporting this work because we know that gender statistics are imperative in order to deliver effective policy and programs that will actually transform the lives of girls and women. But it's actually part of a package of investments in which Australia is involved in order to close gender data gaps in our region. We're building on our support when it comes to the prevalence studies on violence against women in the Pacific. We're assisting the UNFPA's office in our region to strengthen the capacity of national governments in the region to collect prevalence data. That's a core part of my work as Ambassador for Women and Girls, seeking to reduce and eliminate violence against women and girls. To measure the relationship between gender and poverty, we know we need to get beyond household poverty level measurements or household level poverty measurements. We have to measure the well-being and deprivation of individuals. So that's something that Australia is very committed to and is working on. We're actually supporting an innovative individual measure of deprivation, which aims to increase the availability of this data. And we're doing it in partnership with one of our most prestigious universities, the Australian National University, and a civil society organisation, the International Women's Development Agency. So we are very proud to be involved in this. I want you to take note. Take-home message from Australia is we are committed to this process. We are committed to improving global gender data. We're pleased our investments are strengthening the enabling environment for gender statistics and improving their production and accessibility. But as has been acknowledged, none of us can do this alone. That's why this display of commitment and unity is so encouraging and why this message is so important. I urge all development partners to work together to ensure investment and political will are commensurate to meet this critical need. Again, I congratulate everyone on the announcement today, and I look forward to our country working with you all in order to address this absolutely critical issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Despoja. And now I'd like to open the floor for questions. Just to remind you that Papa Sek, who's here, he's not making any opening comments, but he is here and available to answer questions, and he really leads UN Women's efforts to actually increase both the quality and the accessibility of gender statistics. So he is also here to answer questions. We'll take three questions at a time, and we do also have the virtual audience as well. So please put your hand up and we'll get a mic to you. Okay, one at the back there, one at the back there, and then one from the virtual audience.
Hi, I'm wondering where your interest in data comes from. Was it something inspired by challenges you've come across in your own programs that you've run and funded, or something that you've heard from colleagues in the world of development?
Sure, it really comes from business. So if you look at any business around the world today, whether it's DHL, whether it's Google, Microsoft, your local grocery store, they're all collecting data about us because it helps them know where to make investments, where to buy new products, how to change things. And so when I started to say to myself in this women and girls space, where do I want to put another $1,000 down? Where would I go to another philanthropist? Where would I go to the government of a country and say, invest more in this area for women and girls? I had to look at what the data said to know where to put investments down. And what I saw were these enormous gaps. So for instance, in child mortality, how have we done so well against that MDG that was set back before the Sustainable Development Goals? It's because we had good data about childhood mortality, and it's tracked all over the world. Little clinics in Ethiopia that are about the size of this stage, you go in, there's a piece of butcher paper, and they can tell you all the key childhood mortality statistics, and that rolls up to the national and to the global level. So I work predominantly for women's issues. The predominant one the foundation's been working on is family planning, and when we started that work, the data was terrible. And so in 2012, we went about, after we got this global commitment around family planning, building a data system. And now I get a report, you know, every 6 months on my desk that shows 69 countries where they are on a whole host of key indicators so that those governments and civil society and NGOs and we know where we need to place investments. That's the kind of data I want to see, not just for child mortality, not just for diseases, not just for family planning, but for all kinds of things about women and girls. And then we'll know as a world where to make investments, and we'll also be able to follow it up and see with accountability, have we done a good job and are we making progress? To me, that's the only way I can know whether the investments make a difference.
Thank you. There's a question back there. Can you remember just to say who you are and where you're?
I just wish to make a small query from Melinda Gates. This case that you referred to, this about Neelam, the girl in India, which part of the country was it?
Neelam was from UP when I met her.
Okay. Thanks.
And can I please ask you, please remember to say who you are and what your outlet is, just to give us some context. Okay.
Well,
okay, no, you've had your question. Sorry. Next. there was someone else earlier at the back there. Have they gone? Okay, no. In that case, can we have a... Oh, you've got... Okay, go ahead.
I'd like to ask Melinda Gates. I'm Mette Wiebel from Denmark's Radio, Danish broadcaster. I would like to know, can you give an even more concrete example of how collecting data has changed women's life? For instance, you mentioned this with the childbirth, but have you seen something with your own eyes? But you experienced the difference.
Yes, definitely. So I see it all over the world. So here's a great example. A woman who I met a few years ago who's a groundnut farmer, she wouldn't have been counted in any of our data. She lived in Kenya, and yet she was an entrepreneur. She got new seeds, she planted them. She not only was getting more yield off of her farm, she's actually giving that to other people, giving them new seedlings to know what they can plant. And so when I see her and I say, no survey captures what she does, no survey goes and says, because she was also married, her husband was considered the one bringing in income, and yet she's getting this bigger yield on her farm. She was telling me that she was the one who was responsible for the school fees for her children, and yet we don't count her in any survey. We don't even know she exists. And now she's creating other businesses for women. She's my inspiration for saying women count and they matter and let's count them.
At the back there, yeah.
Hello, well thank you for speaking to us. I'm Sonia Narang from California and I report for PRI's The World on radio and other outlets. First, I wanted to know, how are you planning to get accurate and reliable data in so many places around the world? It's often difficult to get the woman to talk openly, and in a household survey, she may defer to the male. So how are you planning to change the way surveys are conducted and to be able to get women to be upfront and honest, even in front of their in-laws or their husbands, and to get reliable data without discrepancies?
Do you want to talk about that a little
bit? Do you want to talk? Yeah. Sure. Give Melinda a break.
Yeah. thank you very much. And this is a great question, and one that we grapple with every day in our work. And sometimes these are also assumptions that we have. So I'll just talk about a project that I'm leading with the UN Statistics Division, where we actually thought that, you know, our starting assumption was that if you go to the household, you ask a question, it's the male who answers. But here, what we ended up having, it was the project is about asking about asset ownership at the individual level. And what we found is that at the household level, even in those surveys, which we thought that is a sensitive topic, we actually pretty much had a bargaining process between husband and wife. So it wasn't because the women were really staying quiet. In, I think, 89% of the cases, it was a bargaining process where the husband says, I own this. The wife says, no, we own it together. So I think these are assumptions that are built into data collection processes. And what I think this investment does is really help us to dig deeper into debunking those assumptions and finding better ways to collect data that gives us accurate information on the lives of women and men.
Okay, and I'm a moderator, so I'm not going to say anything, but data is always contextualized and about contextualization. So if you want good data, you work out the systems to ask the right questions of the right people. So, okay, a whole host of hands went up just then. So we've got one person here and one person there. Mike?
My name is Msimbi Kanyoro. I'm with the Global Fund for Women, and we get money to where women organize for change. I tweeted this morning in excitement about the announcement for the funding for the data, and I got back a response from women who said to me, are we just going to be the data, or are we going to shape how the data about us? And they asked me, is any of this money going to come to women who are organized, women such as the example of Kathy, Ambassador Kathy gave a name of a woman who is an activist, but she's a member of an organization that is working together with her. So they asked me, are they the data, or will they help shape the data, and will they be any of the recipients of this funding? And I'd like you to help me give an answer to them.
Okay, just before that happens, let's take two more questions so that it's a little easier. So there was a question there.
Hi, I'm Annalisa Morelli from Quartz. I had a question about the implementation of this data collection. What are the priorities? What areas are you going to focus on first? And if you have any like deadlines on, you know, how the process is going to move forward.
Great. And then a final question from the virtual audience, and then I'll hand over to the panel.
Thank you. This virtual participant asked, how can we make sure that young women like Maureen are part of closing this gender data gap?
Great. Okay. So, who'd like to start?
Would any? Do you want to start by talking about this?
Yep.
I'll take that and the young women as well. Certainly on civil society, we at the State Department of the United States government does a tremendous amount of work on women's leadership and supporting civil society. Our view about this, and I say this a lot, is that in the United States, civil society has been absolutely critical to the work that we've done, and I always point to the work we did on the Violence Against Women Act, where civil society pushed, prodded, drove us in a really a positive way to get that done. We value that tremendously. I know in some places that is more challenging than others, but we are strong supporters of civil society and do a lot of work to support that. On Maureen, I just have to go back to that because I think one of the things I would point to is that we recently released an adolescent girls strategy. It's the U.S. strategy on adolescent girls, and that was an important document from the United States government perspective. It took us a good year and a half, 2 years to get it done, and we really wanted to have a solid framework for thinking about how the voices of young women are included, how we're taking into account the particular challenges that they face, and making sure that we're addressing those in programming. And that includes everything from early and forced marriage, FGMC, higher rates of HIV in many places. We work very closely with our PEPFAR colleagues on that. The challenges of keeping girls in a quality education for as long as possible. So we are absolutely committed to trying to do better with that cohort. And their voices need to be a part of that discussion if we want to be at all successful in our work.
Okay, Ambassador Distwood.
Can I also emphasize that the role of civil society, but also working with partners such as NGOs, including UN Women and UNFPA, are critical to the strategy that we have in Australia for our overseas development work. Having said that, when you look at the Pacific region, where we have some of the highest rates of violence against women in the world, the collection of data that Australia has assisted with has been absolutely key to ensuring and shaping our policies, but also our funding and resources, not only in terms of us spending money to collect that data, but then to support women and civil society and those leaders to whom you refer. We support them on the ground, at the coalface, particularly those women and their organisations who work to keep, day in, day out, to keep women and children safe. So that's how we organise funding through shelters, through education, through a range of other policies. So it will result in support for those women, those leaders, and those organisations that you mentioned. Data is such a critical part of that, and that is from that data flows so much of the work that we do in international development.
Okay, we have time for two more questions, and then we'll have to go. There's one person at the back there.
My name is Manal Suedan. I came from Jordan in the Middle East in the Department of Statistics. I would like to ask the panelists if they can share us with any plans, action plans to improve data collection regarding SDGs, and what is the share of the Middle East in this regard? Thank you.
Was there another virtual question or no? Oh, so, okay, someone in here who was, no? Okay, so
my name.
Am I missing someone?
No, can I have a mic already?
You have a mic already?
Yeah. Can I or can I not? Okay, thank you. My name is Rose Ngunangwa Mwalongo from Tanzania. I'm a correspondent with The Guardian IPP Media. My questions, I have two questions. First of all, oh, only one. Oh, dear God. Okay, my question is directed to Madam Melinda Gates with her foundation. We have a problem in regard to, you talked about family planning, but family planning has a lot to do also with the GBV, because a man is normally supposed to decide on how many children ought to be in the family in our Tanzania context. And number two, we have the religious issue. I'm sure you understand that the Roman Catholic do not believe in family planning. How do you tackle that challenge?
Okay.
Okay, why don't I just, maybe I'll try and round some of these up a little bit, because there's also was a previous question in the previous set we didn't quite get to. So let me just start with family planning. And I think it's a great example of what we're gonna try and do with the SDGs and do with the data even in places like the Middle East. The great thing we've been able to do in family planning, a data system, as I said, didn't exist. Now what we've got are actually young women out with their cell phones. I hold it up like this because they've got their cell phones and they're going into villages and they're enumerating women and they're going in and talking to young women when their partner is away from the home. So it gets at this intimacy piece. And we can get in family planning to the issue of what was available, were there stockouts, what were you counseled on? But we can get to the deeper questions, the root things, which was, was there any coercion involved? What did you know about your body? What did you learn? So we have about a dozen questions that are asked. Doesn't take very long. We can enumerate on the cell phone and it goes up to a national statistical survey. That's exactly what you want to have happen in country. And the surveyors themselves are women from the local communities. So to the question earlier about SDGs and the one that was in the back, we, on round SDG 5, we actually have good data around child marriage and FGM. We have pretty good data also about managerial positions and how far women are going in their countries. But around SDG 5, we do not have good data around unpaid work today and political participation at various levels or intimate partner violence. And so I think one of the things we can do, again, if you send young women out as enumerators, you can get into the home through the healthcare worker who's going in when the husband's away, or when the imam is away, or when the priest is away, and that's when you start to get at some of those more intimate questions about partner violence and the other. So we know it can be done, and it's a matter of then building it up.
Okay. Do any of the other panelists have anything specific that you want to say, or should I wrap it up? Okay, great. In which case, I'm now going to wrap this up. I want to, first of all, before I thank the panelists, I just want to remind all of you that there will be a technical briefing about the McKinsey paper immediately after this, and that will include some materials for you to be able to use in the work that you're going to do. And secondly, when the panelists leave, could you all please stay seated just until they've left the room, and then we'll continue. And having said that, I just really want to thank all four of you for a really riveting discussion. Thank you all for everything that you're doing on this agenda. It's really important and it makes a difference.
Thanks
you
very much.
Punches on that one. We thought we were wrapping up, and then they said, wait, so.
No, don't worry. I was just thinking, whoops, okay.
No, you were fine, It was immediately.
political briefing on the McKinsey report. Go ahead and take a seat. If you're not, we're going to invite you to take your conversation outside, and we'll get started with the technical briefing in just a moment. Thank you. All right, if you're not here for the technical briefing, go ahead and step aside and take your conversations outside. At this point in time, I want to introduce you to Anu Magavkar. She's with McKinsey, and she is the author of Deliver the Power of Parity Toward a More Gender Equal Society. She's going to walk through the technical briefing of the report, and I believe there's handouts, so if you don't have one, go ahead and raise your hand and we'll get one to you. All right, can we get one over there? Two, three, four. Terrific. Anu, I'll go ahead and have you come up here while those reports are being handed out.
Thanks,
Mr.
A very good morning. We're absolutely delighted to be here releasing this important work at Women Deliver, and thank you for your interest in it. Like all the work at McKinsey Global Institute, this is very much a report that's intended to bring the fact base into the public domain and to enable people who are interested in the facts and the analysis to actually use that to understand the issues and the opportunities and then perhaps shape interventions and actions that are taken across different sectors of this world's economy with reference to gender. So all of our work is available online. A lot of the data is available online, and it's on a public platform that you can play with and click through and look at different cuts. And as Christy mentioned, we're actually handing out handouts of this short presentation, which just summarizes some of the highlights of the research for you. Could we have the presentation? All right. So it's always useful to start with the baseline, which is what is the situation today. Our research covered 95 countries around the world, which accounted for over 90% of the world's GDP and the world's women. Very representative, therefore, of the global opportunity. In 2014, we found that in these countries, women were about 50% of the population, but only about 37% of world GDP. Now, this is very significant because when you think about GDP, it's actually a concept that summarizes the work that men and women do, which is valued, which is accounted for, which is actually measured, and then which is paid for or compensated. And women have a disproportionately low share of that portion of work, though we all know that they have a disproportionately high share of other kinds of work which is not valued, not accounted for, and so on, which is unpaid care work. And then what's also interesting in terms of the split across regions, when we grouped the 95 countries into these regions, what we found is there is a lot of variation. In some regions in the world, women's share of GDP, or the paid work, is actually lower than 20%. And even in the regions that perform better, it's never really approaching 50%. It seems to stagnate at around 40 to 41%. So no region is doing well enough, and some regions can actually do a lot better. And this is because of three kinds of gender gaps in terms of the world of work. The first is that women really participate in the labor force in fewer numbers than men do. The second is that those who do participate tend to work in part-time jobs more than men do. And then finally, the sectors in which they find employment are typically lower productivity and therefore lower wage paying than the sectors in which men work. So what would happen if these three gaps were systematically bridged in the next 10 years? Our research first looked at the full potential scenario in which men and women operated equally on these dimensions in every country around the world. And that represented a potential incremental GDP of 28 trillion in the year 2025. That's a large number. It's a 26% upside to what GDP would otherwise be. But attaining full parity is challenging. It may not be realistic in a 10-year time frame, partly because of barriers and also partly because these are, at the end of the day, individual choices that families, households, men and women make about how they deploy their time. So rather than looking at the full potential scenario, we looked at what we call the best-in-region scenario. And this scenario is really saying, what if every country in the world achieved the fastest rates of improvement in terms of narrowing the gender gap relative to its own region, so keeping its own stage of development, historical, social, and cultural context intact, within that region, what if you were able to emulate the fastest rates of progress? And that's actually a $12 trillion economic prize or potential in 2025. It's still a very large number. It represents over a percentage point each year of additional economic growth for the world. We think that about 60% of this comes from bringing more women into the workforce, about 240 million more women in the workforce in 2025. And then 20% each comes from correcting the mix of part-time, full-time, and then the sector mix that men work in versus women. Every region in the world has a lot to gain. We think that while the world as a whole would have an 11% potentially higher GDP, this could range from 8 to 16% for different countries and different regions, and therefore everyone really has a stake in making this happen. We then step back because, as we've talked about this morning, we do need to, you can't disassociate a woman's role in the family, in the household, in the community, and in society from what she does in the world of work. So we need to broaden the lens and understand gender equality more broadly. We looked at 15 indicators across four categories. The first was really gender equality in work, where we looked at both paid work and unpaid work. And then we looked at three other categories that we generally combine into a theme called gender equality in society. And these three categories, the first are things that enable women to participate in the economy. The second is legal and political representation and voice of women. And then finally, very basics around the sense of physical security and autonomy that women have. And within each of them, we have multiple indicators. What's very interesting is that some of these are non-traditional. As you think about the business case that people have normally made around gender equality, they haven't taken into account unpaid care work. They haven't really taken into account things like child marriage or violence against women, which do impact women's ability to participate in the economy. Across the 95 countries we looked at, the data is striking and the message is clear. Gender equality in work goes hand in hand with gender equality in society. There is a very strong correlation. The cause-effect nature of this It could be mutually reinforcing, but it's very clear that as societies advance gender equality in society, the likelihood of women playing a larger role in the economy tends to increase. And this is something that's important for us to recognize. We then combined these indicators into one score which summarized where each country and each region is on gender parity. This is a score that goes from 0 to 1. The closer you are to 1, the closer you are to full gender parity. And what we really find is that every region has progress that it can make. So the world has advanced, but every region has not really traversed the full extent of the journey towards gender parity. You have some reds there, which are regions where gender equality is particularly low, but then there are a lot of oranges which represent high inequality as well. How could this change in the next 10 years? We use two lenses to answer this question. The first is, what rates of improvement in gender equality are necessary and possible given the $12 trillion economic prize? To achieve that, how much advancement do we need to make? And the second is, in the context of the Sustainable Development Goals, given that the world has a goal and a commitment on many of these indicators, what rate of progress is required in order for us to be on course to meet those goals? When we combine these, we basically find that there is the possibility and also the imperative for these regions to progress quite a lot. We see the reds turning into oranges. We see the oranges turning into yellows. This is still not the full potential or full parity scenario, so you don't see greens, but it is a pragmatic, realistic, still ambitious, but achievable perspective on how far regions can move. And the largest concentrations of women, which are in East Asia, South Asia, and Sub-Saharan Africa, can each advance on gender equality to the tune of 15 to 17 percentage points over a 10-year period, which would impact millions of women in a beneficial way. We then focus within these 15 indicators on 6. And the reason we pick these 6 are because they are combinations of very large opportunities for improvement. They are also pivotal in terms of being able to drive gender equality in work and in society more broadly. So they are correlated with many indicators. If you move these indicators, you actually influence, you expand the ability to influence gender equality more broadly. And these are really essential services. So amongst the biggest global opportunities we find is unpaid care work. Across every region in the world, this is a very large opportunity. Women do 3 times the amount of unpaid care work as compared to men, and almost 10 times in some parts of the world. And this can be addressed through a set of both the basic services of water, sanitation, and energy, which suck up, the provision of which suck up a lot of time in some of the emerging and developing parts of the world, and also family support services, which really are about paid family leave and assistance in terms of childcare. Other large global opportunities revolve around financial and digital inclusion. The disruptive nature of technology change really means we can harness these to empower a lot more women. It's a big potential area. And then on the health and education side, while some parts of the world have made progress and closed gender gaps, these are still very large opportunities for Sub-Saharan African countries, South Asian countries, and other countries which are still at a stage where family planning, maternal mortality, and gender gaps in education are challenges. And we think that this set of 6, so there are other issues beyond this 6 which are very important, legal protection, violence against women, but this set of 6 is a set of issues that the public sector, the private sector, and the third sector, the social sector, can come together, channel funding, and really make a big difference to drive gender equality more broadly. Now, we saw and heard some of these numbers earlier. If you actually advance these services to the women who really need them, we think there will be a large number of women as well as men and boys who will need to be enabled by these services by 2025. In education, for example, across secondary education as well as tertiary education, the goal is to close the gender gap, but also raise access, raise enrollment, not just for girls, but also boys. We can't progress to a gender equal society if 50% of our children, boys and girls, are dropping out of schools. In family planning, as much as 190 million more women need to be provided these services, on financial and digital inclusion as well. And then finally, in terms of basic services as well as family support services, the numbers are very large. It is important to think about what this will cost. This will take more financial resources than what would otherwise be spent in the normal course. We think that between $1.5 to $2 trillion globally in additional spending, which could come from public or government sources, it could also come from private or individual and household sources, could be a combination of these. This is 20 to 30% more than what the world would otherwise spend in these specific areas in 2025. But the $12 trillion GDP potential that is possible by narrowing these gender gaps and raising access to these services is 6 to 8 times the spending required. As we talked about in the morning, there are about 60% of the countries in our data set where the tax revenues alone on the incremental GDP would help pay for this. In the rest of the countries, we would believe there are untapped opportunities in terms of synergies between many of these areas. If you spend on water and sanitation, your requirements in other areas like healthcare actually come down because the two are very highly correlated and you have mutual benefits. There are also efficiency improvements that technology can drive, and many of those can actually help pay for some of this funding. The mix of the resources required will vary by region. So where in regions where basic services, which is the orange part of this stack, are not really available, basic services will actually demand a large share of resources. Paid leave, childcare, and other family services is actually quite large in other regions or countries. And then education is actually a big resource requirement and investment area practically anywhere in the world. Though the mix and the quantum of investment will, of course, vary by region and country. The report, I'm not going to go into this in detail, but the report and the resources you have talk about a range of interventions and levers. Our original report profiles maybe 75 to 100 different case examples of promising interventions that we've seen actually being applied in different parts of the world. And our work is not prescriptive because these interventions have to be understood and then applied in the context of very regional and specific issues, whether they are in rural communities or cities. But there's a lot of information and a lot of also promising models out there in each of these areas. I'm not going to go through them again in detail, but we can talk about them following this presentation. And these resources are also available to you as a handout. I think the last point I want to make is really the nature of private sector involvement. I think the private sector can actually be a very powerful ally to this whole cause and can adopt a stance of how to really think about its involvement based on different approaches, and each of them is actually useful. So there is the one that focuses very much on employee policies and tries to have, you know, gender-friendly policies for both male and female workers. There is also the stance which some companies use, which says, we want to influence this beyond our own employees. We want to use this to help women in our supply chains, small entrepreneurs or small producers. Some companies are actually seeing these as attractive business opportunities, particularly on the financial and digital inclusion side. And then on CSR as well, the innovation as well as the execution capability of the private sector is being deployed in many core issues. So for example, you know, providing sanitation in primary schools or secondary schools is an area where in India a lot of private sector involvement has actually come forward. Putting it all together, you know, there is, we think, a compelling economic case as well as a business and social case. What is interesting is that across the board, there are neighborhood learnings, good practices, and the positive power of peer pressure, particularly in the context now of data being actually captured, tracked, compared over a period of time in the next 10 years, as we hope it will within the SDG framework. And this is a very positive force that can bring together policy as well as private sector innovations. And just want to again emphasize the last two pieces of this puzzle, which are critical. One, we think, is leadership by both women and men. And then finally, a relentless focus on data measurement and tracking. putting this together, we believe that the set of goals, the 12 trillion, the fact that the investment case exists, it's ambitious, but it's achievable, and it's something worth striving for and moving towards. We'd love to take more questions and share any of the data with you offline. It's also available publicly on our online websites as well. Thanks. Sure. Should we try and combine a couple of questions or just ask for maybe one or two more? Maybe Annalisa first. Yes. So these, thanks for that. These are all great questions. Maybe we can address this and then move to the next. On legal protection, it's very interesting. We did look at, you know, legal protection as one of our set of 15 indicators, and we looked at it globally. And it was very interesting that across all of these, we found five issues on gender inequality, which are actually globally pervasive issues, which haven't been successfully or completely tackled in virtually any region or country of the world where gaps still persist. And legal protection was actually one of them. There is extensive data on at least the enactment of laws. The World Bank actually has a very extensive database. It's not quite as good in terms of tracking enforcement, so it's limited to that extent. But even on enactment, if you think about it, we constructed an index of legal protection for gender that covered maybe four different areas. One was around the rights of women in terms of work, so the kind of work they can do, you know, whether they have access to doing night shifts at work or not, because many of these things are actually quite regulated. The second was around inheritance, access to property, and having an equal voice in a court of law, so are you recognized from that perspective? The third was around sexual harassment, and violence-related issues, what sort of legal protection. And the fourth was really around this whole notion of how much legal protection do you have in terms of unpaid care work, which is even if employees are mandated to provide maternity leave, for example, are they also mandated to offer paternity leave? And when you add up the gender legal protection picture across these four, what you find is that even in several advanced economies, there are gaps. Maybe not in terms of inheritance and property, which is the case in other parts of the world, but in terms of things like parental leave. So this is a gap area globally that we highlight in the work. We don't pick it up in this part of the research because it is actually, I mean, we do believe that something like enforcement of laws is a very important part of data tracking to understand the real complexities. There are laws that protect, you know, children from child marriage in many, many countries, but we know that it's a practice that is widely prevalent. So it's an area that we highlight as something that needs further work. In terms of how to measure unpaid care work, again, that's a great question. It's off the radar simply because it isn't measured. So how do you go about, you know, thinking about its value or its measurement? Most studies actually look at it in terms of time. So you think about labor input as time spent without a value judgment on the value of that time or the purpose of that time, but you track data. And what that data actually finds is that 60% of the unpaid care work related labor inputs are really around routine domestic chores. It's not even taking care of children or, you know, elderly family members. It's the routine stuff. We believe that if you valued this in a very crude or simplistic manner based on a minimum wage, if you assume that all these labor hours were paid a minimum wage, which is obviously at the low end of the estimate, such work would be worth $10 trillion a year in terms of output, if you just thought about the output that way. But again, it's an area where data, I think, really needs to come in, both to baseline it, measure it, understand it better, and also understand the pathways to reduce it. This can be reduced, some portion of it can be reduced by better distribution between family members, but some portions can be reduced by investing in infrastructure and raising productivity. I don't need to spend that much time to gather water if it's available in a tap in my house. That's a productivity gain. It's not about redistribution within the family. And then some portion of it can be marketized. You can actually create jobs to do this for, you know, women or men who want to perform that. So it certainly, I think, merits a lot more study. And then finally, the question on breastfeeding. I think it's very core to the whole notion of, the role women play and how to enable them to choose to work if they want to, even at that early stage of, you know, being a mother. We haven't actually seen data on this, but just experiences are that some of the more progressive companies, even in countries like India, are taking cognizance of this. This is typically happening in sectors which are facing the skill gap. They know that they cannot grow unless they bring, you know, talented, educated, and skilled women into the workforce. So they are propelled by the skills gap, which is constraining growth. And such companies are actively doing things like lactation centers, for example, to actually help women employees. But it is a small dent in what is a very big opportunity or improvement area, and we need to make much more progress on that front. Yeah, great point. Let me take another question.
And the issue of, you know, dealing with this global problem.
Thank you. Another great question. So let's take those two. On financial inclusion and digital inclusion, I think it's quite right. These are very pivotal. They are very important opportunities. They're can trigger a lot of other change and narrowing other gender gaps in work. The thing about them is that the cost of delivering, let's say, digital access, because of technological change, which is disruptive, which means that these costs are actually falling exponentially, or what you get for your dollar is actually rising exponentially. It's very hard to predict what these costs will be in 2025. And we would imagine that as digital access scales up, actually the marginal cost of adding one more woman to the network is near zero, actually. So what we did for digital access is we looked at costs as they are today. And there is actually good data that tells you, you know, what does it cost to have a broadband plan and a handset, right? And we did the costing based on only the gender gap, because in the business as usual case, we think because of these disruptions, you're going to have very widespread access in future. So we didn't talk about, you know, the 2 billion more people who need to come online, because that is almost part of the case, which is not to do with gender, but it's to do with how technology actually drives adoption. But the gender gap portion of that, which is the gap of, let's say, 20% worldwide, that's what we costed, and that's what adds into these numbers. But we're hoping technological change can actually trigger a lot of savings in that area, which is why the numbers are low. On breastfeeding, I think it is really interesting because, as you point out, breastfeeding has very positive synergies with child mortality, and it's something that all governments and health systems would like to promote for that reason. I think some of the ways to deal with situations like this where people are poor and the kind of work they're looking for may not, you know, those kinds of employers or situations may not support lactation centers and breastfeeding centers. But there could be, you know, insurance-like products which could be developed whereby women who have babies can get some cover, which is in lieu of paid maternity leave almost. You know, you can construct a scheme of universal coverage where even if you're in the informal sector, you do receive something to tide you over for those 3 months when you actually may want to focus on breastfeeding. You're not in a position to find an employer-assisted program to help you do that, but you could be part of a, you know, state-sponsored insurance-like scheme that actually gives you an incentive or a voucher or something to help tide that period over. And we do highlight ideas like that as important ideas, given in many of these countries, you know, the informal sector is maybe 80% of the workforce. So you can't really look to large companies and gender-friendly policies to actually solve for them.
Hi, I have another question for you. That's regarding, I was visiting Kenya, and one of the experiences we had there was that some of the young girls said, you know, we can't go to school when we have our period. And have you done any studies about the effect of, you know, culture-based sort of, or just the potential that you don't have any means to buy, you know, sanitation towels, what that means for society and what to do about it?
Thanks.
Hi again. In our country, we have contradiction in the legal framework. It's like the law, the Marriage Act of 1971 allows marriage to a girl of younger than, I mean, from 15 to 15 under parental consent. Meantime, the law, the Child Act, considers any person below the age of 18 as a child. Again, the Elections Act only allows a person of 18 years of age to vote. We have that controversial. Did you find that in your research? I mean, were that mix up between laws, where the other one allows this and the other one disallows it, the same thing?
Okay. Yeah, sure. Okay. Let me take the second one first, which is we didn't actually look at, you know, internal discrepancies within countries in terms of laws. The World Bank study that I mentioned is actually very informative in this regard, so I'd encourage you to look at that. But clearly, it's an issue, so it's worth highlighting and talking about. And if you have conflicting laws and anyway poor enforcement across the board, I would imagine. In terms of girls attaining puberty and having periods, I think we didn't look at, you know, access to hygiene products. It's a very interesting angle and could be a really important barrier. We haven't captured that in our data. I don't think the data on that is easily accessible across a large number of countries, though it's an important issue. What we did look at is levers like the availability of sanitation facilities in schools. This is actually a big barrier. The big reason for girls dropping out at the age of 12 and 13 is because, you know, once they have their periods, very difficult to use a common toilet and so on. There are massive campaigns going on now in India that I'm, you know, familiar with, in which there is a drive to build a girls' toilet in every school, and the private sector has actually been engaged as a champion and is doing a lot of good work here. But I agree with you, we should think through the whole value chain. Yeah. Yes.
It's a fascinating report, and I know that's all we have time for today, so I want to thank you for your time. Let me make sure I have given you the proper reference for her. Anu Magavkar and Partner, McKinsey Global Institute, and she, as I said earlier, is one of the lead authors of the report. So thank you so much for staying around and digging deep on this report, because it is quite fascinating.
Thank you very much indeed.